Welcome to Economics Classes. In our previous class, we were learning about human capital formation in India. In that, we have studied about what is human capital, what is human capital formation, and what are the sources of human capital formation. In that, mainly we have studied about expenditure on health, expenditure on education, expenditure on on-job training, and also migration and information. In this session, we are continuing with the human capital and economic growth. As you learned in your previous session, who can contribute more to the economy of the country? Here, only skilled person, healthy person, and educated, well-educated person can contribute more to the Indian economy or any country's economy. Among a worker in a factory or a software professional, who can contribute more to the country's economy? Here, software professional can earn more than the factory worker. Why? Because software professionals were having highly earning opportunities. Because of that reason, they can earn more. So they can contribute more to the country's economy. Here, you know what is human capital. But what is economic growth? Here, what is economic growth? ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಮಗೆ ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ತಿಳಿದಿರುವಂತೆ ಮಾನವ ಬಂಡವಾಳ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಉತ್ಪಾದನೆಗೆ ಯೋಗ್ಯವಾದಂಥ ಒಂದು ಮಾನವ ಸಂಪನ್ಮೂಲ, ಅಂದರೆ ಉತ್ತಮ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣವನ್ನು ಹೊಂದಿದ ಅಥವಾ ಕೌಶಲ್ಯಗಳನ್ನು ಹೊಂದಿರುವಂತಹ, ಉತ್ಪಾದನಾ ಸಾಮರ್ಥ್ಯಗಳನ್ನು ಹೊಂದಿರುವಂತಹ ಮಾನವ ಸಂಪನ್ಮೂಲವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಮಾನವ ಬಂಡವಾಳ ಅಂತ ಕರಿಬೋದು. ಆದರೆ ಅದೇ ರೀತಿ ಆರ್ಥಿಕ ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಏನು, ಆರ್ಥಿಕ ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆ ಅಥವಾ ಆರ್ಥಿಕ ಅಭಿವೃದ್ಧಿ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಏನು ಅಂತ ನೋಡೋದಾದರೆ, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಆರ್ಥಿಕ ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ದೇಶದ ನೈಜ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಆದಾಯದಲ್ಲಿನ ಹೆಚ್ಚ. ಇಟ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ರಿಯಲ್ ಇನ್ಕಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಕಂಟ್ರಿ. ಇಕಾನಮಿಕ್ ಗ್ರೋತ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ರಿಯಲ್ ಇನ್ಕಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಕಂಟ್ರಿ. ದಟ್ಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಇಕಾನಮಿಕ್ ಗ್ರೋತ್. ಹಿಯರ್ how the human capital is related to the economic growth or economic growth of the country. Human capital in the sense healthy and skilled person in a country. Healthy person can provide uninterrupted labor supply for a longer period of time. Then health is also one of the important factor in human capital formation. Then healthy and skilled people can contribute to the economy. Thus, both the health and education are very important in the growth of the country's economy. ಒಂದು ದೇಶದ ಆರ್ಥಿಕತೆ ವೃದ್ಧಿ ಆಗಬೇಕು, ಅಭಿವೃದ್ಧಿ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಮತ್ತು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಇವೆರಡೂ ಕೂಡ ಬಹಳ ಪ್ರಮುಖವಾಗಿ ಪಾತ್ರವನ್ನು ವಹಿಸ್ತವೆ ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಹೇಳ್ಬೋದು. ಅದರ ದಿನ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್, ಹಿಯರ್ ಆನ್ ಜಾಬ್ ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗ್ಸ್, ಮೈಗ್ರೇಷನ್, ಇನ್ಫಾರ್ಮೇಷನ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದಿ ಜಾಬ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ very important factors in the growth of the country. All these factors influencing on the increase in the income of the person. Also, they helping to increase the capacity of earning of population. This enhanced capacity of labor helps in increasing the productivity of the country, and also it helps in absorption of modern technologies or adoption of modern technologies. Only skilled people can adopt modern technologies, and also education helps them to understand the changing society and its needs. Then the question is, how to measure this enhanced capacity of population, or how to measure the human capital? In this, mainly through the education and health we can measure this human capital. In the case of education, here education is measured in terms of number of years of schooling, teacher-pupil ratio, and enrollment ratios. And also, very important thing is quality of education. And also, health is measured in terms of money. In the sense, per capita income, life expectancy, infant mortality rates, and also other mortality rates. By using these indicators, we can assess the income of the countries, or increase in the real income of the country is more in the countries where good education system and good health is provided to the people. here. In many developed countries, they provide good health facilities and best education facilities so that they can increase in the real income of the countries. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಭಾರತದ ಅರ್ಥವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಯನ್ನು ನೋಡೋದಾದ್ರೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಕೌಶಲ್ಯಭರಿತ ಕಾರ್ಮಿಕ ಸಮೂಹ, ಉತ್ತಮ ಪ್ರಜಾಪ್ರಭುತ್ವ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆ, ವೈವಿಧ್ಯಪೂರ್ಣ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನ ತಂತ್ರಜ್ಞಾನ ಹಾಗೂ ಮೂಲ ಸೌಕರ್ಯಗಳಿಂದಾಗಿ ಭಾರತದ ಆರ್ಥಿಕತೆ ಉನ್ನತ ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆ ಪಥದಲ್ಲಿ ನಡೀತಾ ಇರೋದನ್ನು ನಾವು ನೋಡಬಹುದಾಗಿದೆ. ಹಿಯರ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ರೆಕಗ್ನೈಸ್ಡ್ ದ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲ್ ಇನ್ ಎಕನಾಮಿಕ್ ಗ್ರೌತ್ ಲಾಂಗ್ ಅಗೋ. ವೈ? ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ 7th 5-year ಪ್ಲಾನ್ ಇಟ್ ಸೇಸ್ human resource development has a key role in the development of Indian economy. Here, a country with a large population, it is very important to transform the human resource into human capital. People with health, education and skills, they are the assets of accelerating the income of the country. In this table, you can observe the indicators of development in health and education. Here, in particular, you can observe the indicators. First one is per capita income. Second one is crude death rate per 1,000 people. Next one, infant mortality rate and life expectancy rate. Last one is literacy rate. Here you can find from 1951 to 2016-17 how it is changed. When you come to the real per capita income, in 1951 it is about 5,708. And when you come to the year 2016-17, there you can find it is about 77,654. And in crude death rate also you can find the change from 1951 to 2016-17, how it has changed. Infant mortality rate in 1951, it's about 146, and in 2016-17 it is about 33 per 1,000 people. And life expectancy, here male and female, in 1951 males are having life expectancy of 37.2 years and females 36.2 years. In 2016-17 male life expectancy was 67 years and female life expectancy was 70 years. And literacy rate, in 1951 it is about 16.67 and in 2016-17 it's about 76%. So you can find increase in the literacy level and decrease in the life expectancy, increase in the life expectancy, decrease in the infant mortality rate and crude death rate, and also increase in the per capita income of the people. It means there are some developments year by year. Here there is a development. Why? Because increase in the human capital leads to the increase in the real income of the country. So it can contribute the growth of country's economy. The draft National Education Policy 2019 states that India aspires to take place besides United States and China as the third world's largest economies by 2030-32, and India is the sixth largest economy in the world at present. But if we continue to invest on the human capital formation in upcoming days, we can reach 4th or 5th positions in the world's economy. So we can understand the importance of human capital formation in the country and how it is contributing to the growth of the country's economy and how the country's economy can be a largest economy in the world. Next, human capital and human development. Here it looks like both are similar, human capital and human development. Then what is human capital and what is human development? Manava bandavala matu manava abhivruddhi. Manava bandavaladalli shikshana, aarogya hagu shramada utpadakateyanna hechisuvanta ondu sadhanavannu naavu kaanabahudu. Hage manava abhivruddhiyannu naavu nodlikke hodre illi idu manavana yogakshemakke sambandhisida. ಮಾನವನ ಯೋಗಕ್ಷೇಮಕ್ಕೆ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಹಾಗೂ ಆರೋಗ್ಯಗಳು ಹೇಗೆ ಕೊಡುಗೆಯನ್ನು ನೀಡ್ತವೆ ಅನ್ನೋದನ್ನು ನಾವು ಈ ಮಾನವ ಅಭಿವೃದ್ಧಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡಬಹುದಾಗಿದೆ. ಹ್ಯೂಮನ್ ಕ್ಯಾಪಿಟಲ್ ಕನ್ಸಿಡರ್ಸ್ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಿಬ್ಯೂಟ್ಸ್ ಟು ದ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಪ್ರೊಡಕ್ಟಿವಿಟಿ ಆಫ್ ದ ಲೇಬರ್ಸ್ ಬೈ ದ್ಯಾಟ್ ವೇ. ಇನ್ ದ ಸೆನ್ಸ್ ಹೆಲ್ತ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಿಬ್ಯೂಟಿಂಗ್ ಟು ದ ಇಕಾನಮಿ ಬೈ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸಿಂಗ್ ದ ಕೆಪಾಸಿಟಿ ಆಫ್ ದ ಲೇಬರ್ಸ್ ಟು ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸ್ ಮೋರ್. Human development consists health and education contributing to develop the welfare of the population. But to increase the welfare of the population, health and education are contributing. By that way, it will helpful for the growth of the country's economy. Next concept is state of human capital formation in India. Means prastuta bharatadalli manava bandavala nirmanada ondu sthiti hegide anta nodidare illi as we already studied, if we invest money on health and education and also for on-job training, migration and information, the outcome is human capital, good human capital. Then who will invest money on health and education? This health and education are very much essential for the people. So who will invest money on this health and education in the country? Here normally we can say the government and also private sector investing money on the health and education. In the sectors of health and education, both government institutions and also private institutions we can find. Here in a government we can find several levels, mainly three levels of governments: local self-government, state government and union government. Expenditure on health and education are carried by all the three levels of governments, and also many private institutions running schools, colleges and hospitals. But here we can find the intervention of government in the private institutions also. Why? Because to make health and education available to all the people in the country, and also expenditure of health and education make long term impact, and they cannot be easily retake, they cannot be easily reversed. Hence the government intervention is very much essential. Bharata ondu sayukta vyavasthe rashtravagittu, adaralli kendra sarkara, rajya sarkara hagu sthaniya sarkara vyavasthegalannu olagondide. Samvidhanada nirdeshanadante prati hantadallu aarogya mattu shikshana kuritadante sarkaradinda sakashtu pramanada hanavannu ಖರ್ಚು ಮಾಡಲಾಗ್ತದೆ. ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಮತ್ತು ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಸೇವೆಗಳನ್ನು ಒದಗಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಈಗ ಖಾಸಗಿ ಮತ್ತು ಸರ್ಕಾರಿ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗಳಿದ್ದು ಅವು ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಮತ್ತು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣವನ್ನು ನೀಡುವಲ್ಲಿ ಯಶಸ್ವಿಯಾಗಿ ಕಾರ್ಯನಿರ್ವಹಿಸ್ತಾ ಇವೆ. ಈ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಮತ್ತು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದ ಮೇಲಿನ ವೆಚ್ಚವು ದೇಶದ ಆರ್ಥಿಕ ಮತ್ತು ಸಾಮಾಜಿಕ ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆಗೆ ಒಂದು ಗುರುತರವಾದ ಪರಿಣಾಮವನ್ನು ಬೀರ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಪ್ರಸ್ತುತ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಆರೋಗ್ಯ ಮತ್ತು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ವ್ಯವಸ್ಥೆಗಳನ್ನು ಒದಗಿಸಿಕೊಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಸಚಿವಾಲಯಗಳು, ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಇಲಾಖೆಗಳು, ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ಶೈಕ್ಷಣಿಕ ಸಂಶೋಧನಾ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗಳು, ರಾಜ್ಯ ಶೈಕ್ಷಣಿಕ ಸಂಶೋಧನಾ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗಳು, ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯದ ಧನ ಸಹಾಯ ಆಯೋಗ, ಅಖಿಲ ಭಾರತ ತಾಂತ್ರಿಕ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಮಂಡಳಿ ಮುಂತಾದ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಗಳು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣವನ್ನು ಒದಗಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಶ್ರಮಿಸ್ತಾ ಇವೆ. ವೈದ್ಯಕೀಯ ಸೌಲಭ್ಯಗಳನ್ನು ಒದಗಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರೀಯ ವೈದ್ಯಕೀಯ ಸಂಶೋಧನಾ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆ ಕಾರ್ಯನಿರ್ವಹಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಇನ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಫೈಂಡ್ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಇನ್ ಆಲ್ ದ ಲೆವೆಲ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಗವರ್ಮೆಂಟ್, in union government, state government and department of education in various levels, and organizations like National Council of Education Research and Training, NCERT anta naven karithivo. University Grant Commission, UGC, All India Council of Technical Education, AICTE, are facilitating institutions which come under the education. Similarly, the Ministry of Health in various levels, both in union and state level, and Department of Health in different organizations like ICMR, Indian Council for Medical Research, facilitate institutions which come under the health sector. In countries like India, we are under development. It is not developed country. So large section of population are below the poverty line. They are not able to afford to access basic education and health facilities, mainly health facilities and also higher educations. When the basic education and health are considered as a right of the citizens, then it is essential that government has to provide health and education free of cost. So both the union and state government started spending money on education and health. By that, it's having goal of attaining 100% literacy in the nation.
after spending this money on health and education, we can find some improvements in the level of education, literates, quality of education, and also more and more enrollment in education. Next one is education sector in India. As we learned earlier, government spending money on education, both the central and state governments. Growth in the expenditure of the government on education. Do you know how much money government spending on education? This expenditure made by the government is expressed in two ways. First one is as a percentage of total government expenditure, and second one is as a percentage of GDP. As a percentage of total expenditure of the government, total how much percentage is spent to the education, and as a percentage of GDP, in a gross domestic product, how much we are spending on education. The percentage of total government expenditure indicates that how much important education is. The percentage of education expenditure of GDP expresses how much of our income being committed to the development of education in the country. During 1952 to 2012, how much share of our GDP and how much share of our expenditure of the government is spent on education. Here, from 1952 to 2012, how much income of our country is spent on education? Education expenditure as percentage of total government expenditure, it increases from 7.92% to 11.7%. And the percentage of GDP, if you want to show in the percentage of GDP, it's about from 0.62 to 3.21. So throughout this period, means from 1952 to 2012, expenditure on education is not uniform. Some years we spent more on education, and in some years we have spent less of our income on education. And also we can find elementary education takes a major share of total education expenditure, and the share of the higher education is least. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ನೋಡೋದಾದ್ರೆ ಬಹುಪಾಲು ಶೈಕ್ಷಣಿಕ ವೆಚ್ಚವು ಪ್ರಾಥಮಿಕ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದ ಮೇಲೆ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ, ಹಾಗೆ ಉನ್ನತ ಮತ್ತು ತಾಂತ್ರಿಕ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದ ಮೇಲೆ ಮಾಡುವಂಥ ವೆಚ್ಚ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಆಗಿದೆ. ಆದರೂ ಸಹ ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಪ್ರತಿಯೊಬ್ಬ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿಯ ಮೇಲೆ, ಪ್ರತಿಯೊಬ್ಬ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿಯ ಮೇಲೆ ಮಾಡುವಂಥ ತಲಾ ವೆಚ್ಚವು ಹೆಚ್ಚಾಗ್ತಾನೆ ಇದೆ. ಹಾಗೂ ವಿವಿಧ ಆಯೋಗಗಳು ಮಾಡಿದ ಅಧ್ಯಯನಗಳ ಪ್ರಕಾರ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದ ಮೇಲೆ ಮಾಡುವಂಥ ವೆಚ್ಚ ಬಹಳ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಇದೆ ಅನ್ನೋದು ನಮಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಉದಾಹರಣೆಗೆ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಆಯೋಗ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದ ಮೇಲೆ ಜಿ ಡಿ ಪಿಯ ಶೇಕಡ 6% ವೆಚ್ಚ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಶಿಫಾರಸು ಮಾಡಿತ್ತು. ಆದರೆ ನಾವು 2012 ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರೋದು ಕೇವಲ 3.31% ಆಫ್ ಜಿ ಡಿ ಪಿ. ಮತ್ತೊಂದು ವರದಿ ಪ್ರಕಾರ, ತಪಸ್ ಮುಜುಮ್ದಾರ್ ವರದಿ ಪ್ರಕಾರ 10 ವರ್ಷಗಳ ಅವಧಿಯಲ್ಲಿ, ಅಂದರೆ 1998 2007 6-14 ವರ್ಷದೊಳಗಿನ ಮಕ್ಕಳನ್ನ ಶಾಲೆಗೆ ಸೇರಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ 1.37 ಕೋಟಿ ಲಕ್ಷ ರೂಪಾಯಿಗಳಷ್ಟು ಹಣವನ್ನು ನಾವು ವ್ಯಯಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ ಅಂತ ಶಿಫಾರಸು ಮಾಡಿತ್ತು. ಹಾಗೆ ಭಾರತ ಸರ್ಕಾರ ಈ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದ ಮೇಲಿನ ವೆಚ್ಚಗಳನ್ನು ಕ್ರೋಢೀಕರಿಸುವ ಸಲುವಾಗಿ, ಆ ವೆಚ್ಚವನ್ನು ಸರಿದೂಗಿಸಿಕೊಳ್ಳುವ ಸಲುವಾಗಿ 2% ಸೆಸ್ ಅಥವಾ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಮೇಲ್ತೆರಿಗೆ ಅಂತ ನಾವೇನು ಕರಿತೀವೋ ಅದನ್ನು ವಿಧಿಸಲಾಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಆ ತೆರಿಗೆಯಿಂದ ಸಂಗ್ರಹವಾದಂಥ ಹಣವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದ ವೆಚ್ಚಕ್ಕೆ ಮೀಸಲಿಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇವೆ. ಇವು ಪ್ರಸ್ತುತ ಭಾರತದ ಶೈಕ್ಷಣಿಕ ಬೆಳವಣಿಗೆಯ ಒಂದು ನೋಟ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಸೀ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದ ಅಚೀವ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್, ಹಿಯರ್ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಫೈಂಡ್ ದ ಡೆವಲಪ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಲಿಟ್ರಸಿ ರೇಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಇನ್ ಎನ್ರೋಲ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಟ್ರೇಡಿಂಗ್ ರೇಷಿಯೋಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ಕ್ರೀಸ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಯೂತ್ ಲಿಟ್ರಸಿ. ಇಫ್ ಯು ವಾಂಟ್ ಟು ಸೀ ದ ಎಜುಕೇಷನಲ್ ಅಚೀವ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ,
Educational achievements in the country are indicated in the terms of adult literacy rate, primary education completion rate, and the youth literacy rate. In the following table, we can observe that percentage of adult literacy rate in that male and female, primary completion rate male and female, and youth literacy rate both male and female. Here from 1952, here from 1990 to 2017-18, how the rates changed. Here if you want to see the adult literacy rate, in 1990, 61.9 males and 37.9 females. In 2000, 68.4 males and 45.4 females. And in 2011, 79% males and 59% females. And in 2017-18, 82 males and 66 females. So this is how we can find the development year by year. And when you come to the primary completion rates, in 1990, 78 males and 61 females. In 2000, 85 males and 69 females. And in 2011, 92 males and 94 females. And in 2016-17, and in 2017-18, 93 males and 96 females. And when you come to the youth literacy rate, in 1990, 76.6 males and 54.2 females. In 2000, 79.7 males and 64.8 females. In 2011, 90 males and 82 females. And in 2017-18, it's about 93 males and 90 females. So this is how we can find the developments in adult literacy rate, primary completion rate, and youth literacy rate. All these three, we can find some growth in year by year. Next one is future prospects. Though the literacy rate is increasing year by year, still the absolute number of illiterates in India. In 1950, when the Constitution of India passed by the Constituent Assembly, it was noted in Directive Principles of State Policy that government should provide free and compulsory education for all the children up to the age of 6 year to 14 year within the 10 years of commencement of Constitution of India. And about gender equality, it's better than before. Here nowadays the difference between the literacy rate of male and female are narrowed. ಇತ್ತೀಚಿನ ದಿನಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ತ್ರೀ ಪುರುಷರ ನಡುವಿನ ಸಾಕ್ಷರತಾ ದರ ಇರುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ವ್ಯತ್ಯಾಸ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇದೆ. ಅಂದರೆ ಸ್ತ್ರೀ ಪುರುಷರು ಸಮಾನವಾಗಿ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣವನ್ನು ಪಡಿತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಹೈಯರ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್, ಉನ್ನತ ವ್ಯಾಸಂಗ, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಉನ್ನತ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದವರೆಗೆ ತಲುಪುವವರ ಸಂಖ್ಯೆ ಇನ್ನೂ ಕೂಡ ಕಡಿಮೆ ಇರುವುದನ್ನು ನಾವು ಕಾಣಬಹುದು. ಹಿಯರ್ ವಿ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಅಬ್ಸರ್ವ್ ದಟ್ ದ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಎಜುಕೇಷನ್ ಪಿರಾಮಿಡ್ ಈಸ್ ಸ್ಟೀಪ್, it indicating lesser and lesser people reaching to the higher educations. Moreover, unemployment among the youth is increasing day by day. As per the NSSO report 2011 and 12, the rate of unemployment among the youth males who are graduates in rural area was 19% and in urban area it was 16%. When you come to the female unemployment, here 30% of the women graduates are unemployed today. So unemployment is one of the major challenges in the country. So finally, in this chapter we have learnt about investment in education and health convert the human beings into human capital. This human capital can contribute to the growth of the country's economy and its productivity. Investment in education
on the job training, migration and information are the main source of human capital formations. Investment in the human capital formation is considered as efficiency and growth enhance of the economy of the country. Human development is based on the health and education, promotion of health and education among the population. And we have learned about the expenditure made by the government for the promotion of health and education in the country. And what are the impact of these expenditures and its importance in the country. Thank you.